Good morning and welcome to our service of worship this morning. We're here to worship the Lord and to praise Him, knowing that God is Spirit, and those who worship Him must worship in spirit and in truth. There's times when it's good to call one another to worship, to use Scripture to call one another together. And I want us to do that this morning by using as a call together the Canticle of the Jubilate, which in the prayer books is page 104 in the Ordinary Prayer Books, page 37 in the large print. And just as you remain seated, I want us to read this together and listen to it as a call to one another to come into God's presence and to worship the Lord. So let's read together the Jubilate. O shout to the Lord in triumph, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before his face with songs of joy. Know that the Lord, He is God. It is He who has made us, and we are His. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Come into His gates with thanksgiving, and into His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and bless His name. For the Lord is good. His loving mercy is forever. His faithfulness throughout all generations. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. As we come together as His children when we know Jesus. We come together as those who have fallen and failed to live the way in the weeks that passed. We come to seek forgiveness and cleansing. Beloved in Christ, we come together to offer to Almighty God our worship and praise and thanksgiving, to confess our sins and to receive God's forgiveness, to hear His holy word proclaimed, to bring before Him our needs and the needs of the world, and to pray that in the power of His Spirit we may serve Him and know the greatness of His love. We acknowledge our sin as we join in the general confession, page 102 in the Ordinary Books. Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbor in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault, by what we have done and by what we have failed to do. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We stand. O Lord, open our lips. O God, make speed to save us. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen. Praise the Lord. We continue to praise the Lord. We join in a hymn, number 96 in the hymn books. Jesus is Lord, number 96.
Thank you.
It's page 660 in the prayer books, 660, and I've just found it in the big print prayer books. It's 376 in the big print prayer books. Let's read it together. Read it in unison. A psalm of praise and longing. O God, you are my God. Eagerly I seek you. My soul is athirst for you. My flesh also faints for you in a dry and weary land where there is no water. So I would gaze upon you in your holy place, that I might behold your power and glory. Your loving kindness is better than life itself, and so my lips shall praise you. I will bless you as long as I live, and lift up my hands in your name. My soul shall be satisfied as with marrow and fatness, and my mouth shall praise you with joyful lips. When I remember you upon my bed, and meditate on you in the watches of the night, for you have been my helper, and under the shadow of your wings will I rejoice. My soul clings to you. Your right hand shall hold me fast. But those who seek my soul to destroy it shall go down to the depths of the earth. Let them fall by the edge of the sword and become a portion for jackals. But the king shall rejoice in God. All those who swear by him shall be glad. For the mouth of those who speak lies shall be stopped. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen. Jean Beanie is our new youth family worker, and Ross is going to come and interview her now. Take your seats, please.
Thanks, Norman. Good morning. It's a real pleasure to be able to introduce Jean and her lovely family who are with us today. Rather than me interview her, I'm just going to pass the microphone over to Jean, and Jean's going to tell us a wee bit about herself and her men. Okay, Jean.
Hello, hopefully you can all hear me now. It's lovely to see you all this morning on such a beautiful morning outside. So, I'm Jean, and I live not too far away. I live just down in Newtownards, so some of you probably know where that is, and I'm sure you've had a little visit down there, maybe for some shopping. It's a great town for some shopping and some coffee. So, I am so excited to be coming along to St. John's to get to know all of you and all of our young people. And I got to meet some of them earlier on at the other service, and that was great fun. So, I have three boys and my husband with me today, so they'll maybe give you a wave now. They're sitting just down there, about halfway down. So this is Paul, my husband, and then my three sons. So Jacob's the eldest one. He'll give you a little wave, hopefully. And then Adam in the middle. Where's Adam? There you are. Okay, brilliant. He's helping me out with getting all the right pages in the book there, Adam. You did a great job. And then Jude is hiding. Oh, there he is. He just popped up. Jude's a bit tired by now, I think. Aren't you, Jude? Yes. So Jude's in P1. So we've got P1, P5, and year 9, or the old second year, as it used to be called. So 4 school years apart for all my boys. So, that's all my boys. But then, as I said earlier as well, I am a part-time teacher. So I work in an all-girls school. So I've got my girls in school, and that's in Victoria College up in Belfast. I teach a couple of days a week there, English and RE. So I've got the balance there, the boys and the girls. So it's great to be here this morning and see so many friendly faces. So,
yeah. Well, we're very excited that you're here and that you're starting work today. Just so that you know, the role is slightly different from the role that Aoife did. Jane will be in charge of all our under 18 ministry and giving vision leadership to that, but with a particular emphasis on young people, so 12 to 18, the secondary school age kids. She'll be particularly hands-on with that age group, but giving leadership to the whole of the under 18s program. So we need to be praying for Jane. Can I ask you to be praying for Jane, for Paul, for the boys in this time of transition? And can we pray for them now? Let's pray together, and I'll lead. Father, we thank you so much for bringing the Beanies to us, Lord, for connecting us with Jane. And we pray, Lord, that as she takes up this role, would you, Holy Spirit, anoint her for the task. Lord, all of us need your help, and we pray in particular for Jane, that she would be filled with your Spirit, that she would have your wisdom, that she would have your ideas and inspiration. We pray for the relationships with our children and young people, that they would deepen quickly, and Lord, that she would be able to foster friendship and faith among our younger members, Lord, for your glory. So bless her in her role. And Lord, for Paul and for the boys, Lord, we pray for them also, that this period of change would be really good for them also. Be with this family, living God. Bless them in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You'll understand that these guys have been here since about 9:45, so they're going to quietly slip away, but it's been great that they've been able to come to both services and say hello. God bless you. Thanks, Norman.
Since I'm in a sense of a member of the congregation at the minute, leading the service, I think we should all say a big word of welcome. Maybe just show a round of applause as a welcome too. Let's stand and sing together our second hymn. It's number 682, All Created Things. 682, All Created Things. To remain standing, we join together in the creed and profess our faith in the living God. Page 112 in the ordinary prayer books, and I think something else in the other one. 48, is it? 48 in the other one. Let's profess our faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again, he ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We pray in the words of the versicles and responses. Show us your mercy, O Lord.
And grant us your salvation.
O Lord, save the king, the Queen.
And grant
let your ministers be clothed with righteousness.
And
O Lord, save your people. Give peace in our time, O Lord. O God, may clean our hearts within us. We pray in litany form. I'll say, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer as your response at the end of each set of litanies. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, you promised through your Son, Jesus Christ, to hear the prayers of those who ask in faith. Lord, we pray for your church. Lord of your people, strengthen your church in our province, in our island, in our land. Strengthen us in the faith of St. Patrick. Strengthen us in the witness and the worship of St. Patrick. Strengthen us in pointing other people to you, the Lord of all the earth. Renew the life of this diocese, bless David, our bishop, and build us all up in faith and love. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of creation, look with favor on the world you have made. Lord, we praise you for its beauty and its wonder and its magnificence. But we see the darkness that creeps abroad and the evil that lurks within. We pray, Lord, that you'll have favor upon us. You'll work in your grace in our lands, in our own land not least. Guide this nation and all the nations, particularly the nation of Ukraine, particularly those people struggling under daily bombardment, and darkness is creeping abroad in the land. Lord, let your light shine, drive back the darkness, and protect the ordinary innocent people, and throw down those that are warmongers. Lord, you raise up those you would raise up, and throw down those you would throw down. We trust you to do it, to your glory and praise. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, of our relationships, sustain in the communities in which we live and work, here in this community here of Orangefield and Castlereagh Road and this general area. Comfort and strengthen us where we live and work. Help us to love our neighbors as ourselves, our neighbors in general, but those neighbors who live next door to us in particular, those who live across the road from us and the street behind us. Lord, let Jesus be seen. Let our lives be witness to him. And protect and guard this neighborhood. Enable us to serve our families and friends and to love one another as you love us. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of all healing, relieve and protect those who are sick or suffering. Lord, Lord, we lift them before you now in quietness, just praying your healing touch and your healing power, your love and mercy towards all. Be with those who have any special need at this time. Not just in the context of the wider world, but in the context of our own area. We ask that you'll deliver all who know danger, violence, or oppression. Lord, in your mercy, Lord of eternity, bind us together by your Holy Spirit. We thank you for those who have gone ahead of us and confessed the faith. We thank you for all who have pointed to Jesus and brought light breaking into the darkness. We pray for those who have lived before us. We pray for those who live around us. We pray for those to whom we have a responsibility because they follow us, and we point them to Jesus. Lord, in your mercy, we continue our prayers by praying together a morning collect, page 114 in the prayer book, page 48, I think, or something like that in the big print. We pray two collects. First of all, the one at the top of the page. O God, author of peace, lover of concord, to know you is eternal life, and to serve you is perfect freedom. Defend us in all assaults of our enemies, that we, surely trusting in your protection, may not fear the power of any adversaries. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We pray the collect at the bottom of the page. Heavenly Father, in whom we live and move and have our being, we humbly pray that your Holy Spirit may so guide and govern us that in all the cares and occupations of our daily life, we may never forget your presence, but remember that we are always walking in your sight through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. And he's going to come to us now, come and now bring us the Bible reading.
Morning's Bible reading comes from Nehemiah chapter 8. I'm very loud. Is it this mic? It's off. I'm loud anyway, but this is quite loud. This morning's reading comes from Nehemiah chapter 8, selected verses. When the seventh month came and the Israelites had settled in their towns, all the people came together as one in the square before the water gate. They told Ezra, the teacher of the law, to bring out the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded for Israel. So on the first day of the seventh month, Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of all men and women who were able to understand. He read it aloud from daybreak till noon as he faced the square before the water gate in the presence of the men, women, and others who could understand. And all the people listened attentively to the book of the law. Ezra, the teacher of the law, stood on a high wooden platform built for the occasion. Ezra opened the book. All the people could see him because he was standing above them. And as he opened it, the people all stood up. Ezra praised the Lord, the great God, and all the people lifted their hands and responded, Amen, Amen. Then they bowed down and worshipped the Lord with their faces to the ground. The Levites instructed the people in the law while the people were standing there. They read from the book of the law of God, making it clear and giving the meaning so that the people understood what was being read. Then Nehemiah the governor, Ezra the priest, and the teachers of the law, and the Levites who were instructing the people said to them all, "This day is holy to the Lord, your God. Do not weep or mourn." For all the people had been weeping as they listened to the words of the law. Nehemiah said, "Go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks, and send some to those who have nothing prepared. This day is holy to our Lord." Then all the people went away to eat and drink, to send portions of food and to celebrate with great joy, because they now understood the words that had been made known to them. On the second day of the month, the heads of all the families, along with the priests and the Levites, gathered around Ezra, the teacher, to give attention to the words of the law. They found written in the law, which the Lord had commanded through Moses, that the Israelites were to live in temporary shelters during the festival of the seventh month, and that they should proclaim his word and spread it throughout their towns and in Jerusalem. "Go out into the hill country and bring back branches from olive and wild olive trees, and from myrtles, palms, and shade trees to make temporary shelters, as it is written." So the people went out and brought back branches and built themselves temporary shelters on their own roofs, in their courtyards, and in the courts of the house of God. From this day on, from Joshua, son of Nun, until that day, the Israelites had not celebrated it like this, and their joy was very great. Day after day, from the first day to the last, Ezra read from the book of the law of God. They celebrated the festival for 7 days, and on the eighth day, in accordance with the regulation, there was an assembly. This is the word of the Lord. Thank you, Norman. I normally only get Andrew when I'm in trouble. So it's usually Andrew or Andrew Michael when I'm really in trouble. Good morning. It's lovely to see you all. It's lovely to be here. I'm going to confess, I did get into trouble at the start of the week. My wife Laura turned 31 on Tuesday. She's not looking too bad for 31, I must say. But I forgot it was her birthday. Oh, no, I feel the tone change there in the church. Monday evening, my Jacob said to me, "Daddy, are you forgetting something?" And this went back and forth because normally it's I've forgotten a football match or I've forgotten to buy him something. But no, credit where credit's due, he was reminding me of his mummy's birthday the next day. So we had a mad dash about 4:30, 4:45 in the evening to Tesco's to buy a caterpillar cake, which Laura's a vegan, she doesn't eat chocolate, but I love chocolate cake. And I love caterpillar cake, so she got a caterpillar cake. We bought her some cards and a few bits and bobs to tide us over. Now, there had been clues that her birthday was coming up. The first clue being, it happens every year. You know, second clue was that a fortnight ago, I came home with Mother's Day gifts ready for the end of the month. And I thought, brilliant, I'm ahead of the game. And Laura said, "Well, my birthday comes up first." And the third and final clue was when she loaded my Amazon basket with all the stuff that she wanted. I did come across it a few weeks ago and think, I didn't want that, I didn't order that. But Laura was thinking ahead. Now, I could claim that I'm far too busy with ecclesiastical matters. I could claim that I'm constantly viewing the word through an eschatological lens, that's a big word, or that the ontological impact of faith is constantly on my mind. But that would be lying. I just forgot. I just literally overlooked it, and nothing could be done at that point. I'm very forgetful, and I wonder how many of you would tend to be forgetful from time to time. I tend to forget some really important things to the point where I have to make notes. I have to make notes on my phone. So you'll often see me typing on my phone. I'm not on Facebook or Twitter. I'm actually reminding myself to do something later on. And you'll be surprised to hear Laura's birthday is now in my phone for next year with an alarm a week beforehand. We've been traveling through Ezra and Nehemiah for quite some time now. It's been a lovely journey. I've really enjoyed these two books, and we've still quite a few chapters to go. And this morning's chapter focuses around the concept of our strength coming in God's joy. It is God's joy that gives us the strength. Now, as I was reading that during the week, I was thinking about the last 2 years in particular. With all that went on with COVID, the Australian bushfires, do you remember them? Before COVID, that was a couple, 3 years ago now. The war in Ukraine, everything seemed to be happening at once. And I felt that there seemed to be a little less joy in the world, a little less security. And I'll admit, I felt very weak and powerless at times. And yet here's Nehemiah telling us, telling the Israelites, that our strength and our resilience and our ability to continue and fight another day is rooted in the joy of the Lord. The joy of the Lord is what gives us the ability to get up in the morning and keep going. It certainly is for me. And this concept should be too far-fetched for us all. I'm assuming most of you will have a faith since you're here on a Sunday morning. So you'll be aware just how important God is. But chapter 8 is all about the Israelites coming together to hear the law of Moses being read by Ezra. What's important about this is that it's everyone. Everyone comes together. All the individuals and unique human beings come together as one to listen to the word of God. They bring their baggage and their doubts, their blessings and their fears, their happiness and their sorrow, and they are united before God. How wonderful is that? That applies to us this morning as well, as many of you will have come this morning with your own worries and doubts and baggage, and yet we're united this morning. When I was little, I was taught to respect my elders. I was taught to respect police officers. I was taught to respect doctors and nurses. And I was taught to respect teachers. I'm going to be honest, I did occasionally slip up when it came to teachers. And my mum would often have got letters sent home with me to tell her what I had done. They never made it home, but they did get sent home. So they often wondered why my mother never replied. She never knew. She never knew. But one person I can remember being told that we had to follow and listen to and never question was the minister of our parish church. We were not allowed to question him. We were not allowed to raise an issue. My grandmother was strict on that. You listen to him. He's a man of the cloth, man of God. Don't challenge him. His word was absolute and above reproach. But Ezra and Nehemiah, they don't agree with that. In fact, they say something very different. They say that everybody is equal. Everybody has a role to play, and everybody has the right to serve in the priesthood. We see a similar struggle today, and I was thinking back to selection a few years ago to get into training. There's a struggle when it comes to theological courses, because the church has to make a decision on you within a very short space of time. I maybe attended 4 or 5 meetings. Then I went on to selection, and I had 3 interviews, and that was it. And the church had to make a decision. I wonder, though, do you really know anyone in that short space of time? Do we really know ourselves in that short space of time? But here we see Ezra reading the law to the people. Ezra has been dragged out and commanded to read the law. He's been instructed by the people. Ezra was being supported, though. He was not on his own. He was being supported by everyone around him. There was no higher. There was no lower. Only the word of God was elevated, and rightly so. Men, women, and children who came together were equal, the same as each of us this morning are equal in the eyes of God. Some Christians and some denominations may well read this text and read the law of Moses in a very patriarchal manner. But Nehemiah doesn't lend itself to that interpretation. Rather, Nehemiah is a reminder of that equality, of the fact that every man, woman, and child is made in his image, that we are all very special and equal to him. Chapter 8 is also very unique in its acknowledgement of the authority of what we call the Pentateuch, which is known better to us as the first five books of the Old Testament. There is no doubt, as we read the Old Testament, that the law of Moses, the word of God, was accepted and engaged with and indeed revered before this point in history. But it's worth noting this morning how in our canon, in the final form that it took, this is where such a recognition takes place. For this new emerging community that is finding its shape and its voice, the story of Israel and her ancestors, not to mention the instructions from God, makes the community a joyful and wholesome one. They need it all in order to make the community whole. These people are commencing their joint existence, and I love this bit, with the development of tradition. They are using tradition to build their community and their church. And before Scripture even takes its final shape, it's been built by word of mouth, by tradition, by local custom. And that's also the same afterwards in its understanding and interpretation. But for all of us this morning, the challenge really comes in the second half of verse 3, when as the people gathered to hear the law being read by Ezra, I love this, all the people listened attentively to the book of the law. Show of hands, ladies and gentlemen, how many of you listen attentively on a Sunday morning to the sermon? Oh, go on, really? I'm impressed. Did you notice my hand didn't go up? Why don't we listen attentively? Because we get distracted sometimes, don't we? I am forever getting distracted. And it seems to have rubbed off on Jacob. He can't hold his focus for any length of time. Perhaps that's why I liked my previous career, because it was all very fast-paced and blue lights and emergencies. But some of us do get distracted, and that's okay. That's fine. But here in the book of Nehemiah, we see that all the people listened attentively. I was thinking as well, though, just how much our life is impacted now with social media, with the constant changing dynamics of families and relationships, the changing attitudes to gender, to sexuality, or indeed life in general. I find all that and all the pressures of that can sometimes affect my ability to listen attentively. So there's a challenge there, a challenge for all of us to replicate the community we see in Nehemiah and listen not just on the Sunday, but throughout the week, through regular study, regular fellowship, and in my opinion, my very humble opinion, the most important, through prayer. If those near TV screens will see a map of predominantly Europe, Asia, and Africa, this is colored in. If I was to ask you what Iran, Afghanistan, North Korea, Somalia, Egypt, and United Arab Emirates, to name but a few, have in common, what do you think it is? What book is banned or severely restricted in these countries? The Bible. The book that I opened this morning and read from, the book that I scribble in, and I make notes in, and I highlight bits to come back to, that's banned in an awful lot of countries. Or there are such heavy restrictions on them that it's almost impossible to buy a copy, obtain a copy, keep a copy, or evangelize from it. In North Korea, as you go in, I was watching a documentary on a journey around Korea recently, and as you go to the border, they ask you, do you have a Bible? And then they will search your luggage. For some across the world, the Bible is seen as a dangerous book. And in some ways, it is. It's not dangerous to you and I. In fact, it strengthens us. It builds us up. I find great comfort from my Bible. But for the dictators and despots out there in the world, the Bible is the most dangerous book that they have to face. It is the most dangerous piece of literature that could get into anyone else's hands, because the Bible tells us not to accept social injustice. It tells us to trust in God and to stand up and be counted. So take comfort in the fact that we can read our Bible. But I would ask that you pray regularly that the rest of the world sees the Bible for what it really is. And those that see it as dangerous fall away to the side. When I started training about 5 years ago, I kept a notebook on my desk. And every time I read a term I didn't know or didn't recognize, and in theology there is an awful, awful lot of terms, I would research the word and make a note. But I'd put the note in my own words, so I knew when I went back I would understand it. When I came across the word again, I opened it, I found the definition, and I then applied it. And it started to reinforce the terms and what they actually meant. And within this reading this morning, 13 Levites, and there was 13 of them, and I've put their names up on the screens if you're near a screen. I wasn't going to try and read their names because they are somewhat interesting. These 13 Levites, all of whom we would deem today in the church to be laity, they weren't priests, they weren't clergy, but they realized that it didn't matter what title they had. It didn't matter what term people used to describe them. It didn't matter if they were in a fancy role, if they wore robes. What mattered was the ability to help others, to help others engage with the word of God. And in verse 7 and 8, we see these 13 Levites help the people around them by making the text clear, by breaking it down and giving it meaning. Whereas in verse 2, we've seen that Ezra was reading to those who were able to understand. The focus shifts and it becomes a real church, a real community, and everyone gets the opportunity to engage with God's word and understand it. The community of men, women, and children here most likely couldn't read or write. There wasn't the same education as we'd have today. They needed somebody to take the time and explain it. So those who had gathered to hear the law of Moses were moved. And indeed, we're told that all of them were weeping. They were crying as they listened to the words of the law being read to them. They were told not to cry. They were told not to cry because the day is holy to the Lord. Sometimes you just need a good cry. I'm a firm believer, and I know I've spoken and touched briefly on men's mental health before, but I'm a firm believer that men do not cry as much as they need to or should. The fact that we are built to cry is a sign that we should be doing it when we need to. And there's all sorts of different tears. There's tears of happiness, tears of sadness, and in the case of our house, quite often tears of laughter. This week, as I went to kick a football into our net at home for Jacob, I slipped on the grass and landed on my derriere, and Jacob found this absolutely hilarious. It's one of the reasons I don't play sports. But standing in the presence of the Word of God is being in the actual presence of God. When we stand before God here on a Sunday morning, we should be feeling emotions. We should feel moved. God's love for us is so huge and incomprehensible that for me, I find myself in awe and wonder of him. I find myself quite often moved. And if we don't feel moved, if we don't feel those emotions, perhaps we just need to reconnect a little bit more with God. But Nehemiah wasn't chastising those who were upset. If we read on in the chapter, he was actually highlighting how this day was a celebration. He was highlighting that they were celebrating God and God's love for them. The gap between the law and their lives was becoming increasingly obvious, not just to Nehemiah, but to those who had gathered. But instead of seeing the day as a punishment from God, which is a concept that I personally and theologically don't accept, as a loving, kind, and caring God would not set out to hurt his creation. But this day for the Israelites is a holy day from a loving God, a day set apart from God, a time for celebration, a time for eating, banqueting. The fact, the thought of choice food and sweet drinks was music to my ears when I read it. They go from hearing the law to celebrating God and each other in his glory. God's joy, his happiness at his creation, his happiness with the Israelites, sees the Israelites rejuvenated and strengthened. Joy in the Lord reminds us that dedicating our lives to God, committing to his ways and to his laws, is not a restriction, but it's actually a freedom. And it's a freedom that all of us can avail of. By trusting God and turning to him in our times of need and sorrow, we find refuge from a world that is cold, a world where there is pain and suffering. Whilst our bodies, our physical bodies, may feel emotion and may deteriorate, our souls can grow and become stronger in the presence of God. Husbands, this next part's directed at you. How often do you do a task in the house that you've been instructed to do by the wife and you do it wrong? Every time. I cannot do a task in the house without Laura saying, "That's not what I meant. That's not what I said." How often perhaps do you interpret a task or instruction to find out it should have been done in a different way? Or you might even have done something for many, many years to discover that's not the way it should be done. For the Israelites, they discovered through Ezra's teaching and instruction that they weren't following the requirements for the Festival of Tabernacles quite the way that they should have. I think I would have gone into a bit of a tailspin and started to panic if I'd found that out, trying to find an explanation or an excuse or perhaps somebody to blame. It would have been quite easy for the Israelites to become almost paralyzed with fear, worrying about what God was going to do. But God isn't there to become angry and punish. God actually reacted to their reverence, to their commitment. The Levites, the heads of the families and the priests, they took action. They realized what they were doing wasn't right and they took action to resolve it. They put right what was wrong for so many years. And part of putting things right was the requirement to erect temporary shelters for the entire festival. Understanding the text in its entirety and within the context of when it was written meant that the people could not just understand it, but be obedient to it. This obedience in turn led to great joy, a joy that had been lacking because they had not celebrated or marked the festival in the way the law required them to do. You'll have to excuse my very pitiful Hebrew here. There is a word that is spelled S-A-M-A, Sama, I believe. And it's used in the original text to represent hear, to hear the word. But, as is the case with most Hebrew words, there are multiple meanings to it. Sama means, yes, to hear, but also to obey. So when it is used in the context of Nehemiah, we are told to listen and to obey. Ezra continued to read the book of the law of God for the entire festival. And he did so because he knew it was much more important that the law be heard and obeyed than to pay lip service only once. In today's setting, we're much more conscious of our various styles of worship, our various styles of reading scripture, and our own theological standpoints. Even those of us who maybe don't think we have a theological standpoint do. And whether that be traditional, evangelical, contemporary, reformed, whatever the case may be for you personally, always be mindful and conscious that it will influence how you read a piece of scripture. It will influence how you interpret something. Understanding all the words and being aware of the context, knowing the cultural history are all very important, but they're really insignificant to the need to be obedient. And that obedience applies whether a text is addressed to us, whether we think it applies to us, it applies and requires our obedience. But unlike the obedience of a slave to master in times gone by, or an obedience that focused upon one person being superior to the other, one that focused on ownership rather than equality, the obedience in Nehemiah is one of total submission to God. Submission is part of a community or church body, being receptive to God's call upon our lives and answering that call when you hear it. By doing so, by observing with reverence the celebrations and joy that we find in our church calendar, we can experience true rejoicing with God. And as I finish, let me assure you that I made up for my forgetfulness last Monday, and I took Laura out for a nice dinner and some 10-pin bowling, which cost me a fortune. So next year, I will remember. Amen.
Just a few notices to share before Norman prays for us as we close. Prayer club Tuesday night, you could meet in the rectory to pray, or you can meet on Zoom, but we'd love to have as many as possible join us weekly to pray for church life and for our community. Every Wednesday we're meeting for Holy Communion next door in the Jeffers room, so if you would like to join us at 10 a.m. every morning, every Wednesday morning, we'll be sharing communion together over Lent. Our third and final Andy's Anglican Angle is happening this Wednesday in the Duffin room, so the back room, just through the glass doors. They've been excellent. We've really enjoyed engaging with different aspects of Anglicanism. And this week it is liturgy we're going to look at, so 8 o'clock on Wednesday night, and we'll be looking at Anglican liturgy. Thursday men, 11 o'clock, if you would like to join with other men for a coffee and a chat, meet in Orangefield Presbyterian, the Ark Cafe, at 11 a.m. And TOTS is happening every Friday at 10 a.m. If you'd like to be part of the team, or if you know a neighbor or someone in your family who has a young one, a toddler, then do let them know and invite them along. It's for everybody, TOTS and carers together. This Friday night, folks, we have our Harmonic Sounds concert. So Harmonic Sounds is a band that Gwen McBride's part of, and they're going to be playing here in aid of Northern Ireland Children's Hospice. So it's free entry, but then we're invited to give to that very worthy cause. It'll be a very good evening of music. I'd invite you to come along and to join in and to support that effort. Friday night, 7:45 here in the church. And then two advance notices, one that Prime Timers is beginning on Thursday week. So Thursday, March the 31st at 2 o'clock. It's going to be great to get that up and running again. So do come along if you're a senior, 2 o'clock Thursday week, March 31st. That's in the Kennedy Rooms out the back. And last but not least, there's an opportunity to go deeper in the Bible. The diocese is offering a Bible course beginning April, May. You can have a taster evening on the 7th of April at 7:30. If you're interested in finding out more, talk to me. I'll send you more information, but the first port of call is joining in that taster evening and seeing if you think that's something you want to have a go at. But it'll be a really excellent course, and it's an opportunity to do what we've been hearing about today, to go a bit deeper, to engage with God's word. Norman, I'll hand back to you.
And now to him who by the power at work within us is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you this day, remain with you forever. Amen. We conclude our worship with hymn number 94, In the Name of Jesus. As you can see, there are quite a few verses in it, but it had already been decided that we'd omit the starred verses 2, 3, and 6. Sing the rest of them to the glory of Jesus. Hymn number 94.